Welcome to week number 159,220 in lockdown. This is the most positive place you'll find on a Saturday morning. Excited to have another action-packed Zoom call for the Robert Heffernan Academy, and great to see big numbers on the call. I can already see we have people on it from USA and Canada, which is the middle of the night, and we have people on it from Australia and New Zealand, which is late evening for them, and obviously it's 10:30 in Irish time. Delighted to have such big numbers on, guys, and I keep saying, and we say it every week, as soon as we get out of lockdown, competition will start practically immediately, so the people who are training during this period of time will be the ones who will reap the rewards when the competition comes back. So we've got a special class. I think I'll be the only one who's going to be speaking who isn't a world champion, so once I get over that insecurity, I'll be fine. But we're delighted, first of all, to have Kate Veale joining us, who is a 2011 World Youth Champion. And Kate will do a few Q&A, and we're going to ask people to put their questions in the chat box. I'll lead it off, and we'll ask people also to mute themselves as well, if you don't mind, so we can hear. So, yeah, if you can, everyone can mute themselves, please. That'd be great. Unmute. Yeah. I hope you can see it. Yep. So if you ask everyone to mute themselves for the time being, just so people can hear. What I want to do is I want to switch on to a few videos.
Far over is in the farthest away from
my... Yeah, that's to keep muting people because we want to make sure people can hear. I'm going to start off with a video of Kate. I hope it works on the screensaver, and I hope the sound is working as well. So just bear with me while I show you two videos of Kate walking before I do the introductions. The first one is from the World Youth Championship, the World Youth Olympic Games in 2010.
The Vishan Stadium now for the first evening of competition in athletics. The women's 5,000 meter walk up first. The favorite in this event is Alina Galchenko of the Ukraine, the first to be introduced and expected to be the first to cross the line if she walks the kind of race that she can. 22 minutes, 19 seconds, her personal best. The 5,000 meter or 5K distance is a very popular amateur distance for recreational runners. If you compare your own personal running time to these race walk times between 22 and 25 minutes, you realize how fast these women are able to move in this very unique style. The reason for that style, one foot must appear in contact with the ground at all times. If anyone appears to run or adopt a running style, disqualification is automatic. The initial stages here, the pack staying together, but it is the favorite, Alina Galchenko of the Ukraine, who is out in front. Over halfway now, you can see Galchenko in the lead, Leontieva of Russia in second. Not a surprise there, and Kate Veale of Ireland in third, the fourth up with the pack, Anna Clement of Italy. There is an opportunity to fuel up during this walk, somewhat unusual at this distance, but the evenings in Singapore remain very humid as Kate Veale refuels here for the final stretch. As this lead group comes into the last few minutes of the race, they will lap those who are struggling in these conditions. That lead pack would stay essentially fixed until just a couple of laps remain when Galchenko starts to pull ahead. This is a big distance in this race walk, much more difficult to accelerate and charge ahead in this kind of event, the way you often see in running races. But somehow that is not the case here as Clement and Mao catch Galchenko and watch the leader. She falls here. Unbelievably, she gets back up to finish this race, but she will finish it empty-handed. Her medal has disappeared. Instead, at the finish, it will be Anna Clement of Italy, the Chinese runner with the silver, and bronze to Leontieva. Galchenko finishes this race without a medal as these women collapse from sheer exhaustion at the finish, and Galchenko just in terrible shape after this race. This heat and humidity seemingly taking just an awful...
So there you go, guys. That was the Youth Olympic Games in 2010, where Kate Veale from Waterford finished in fourth place in Singapore, a long way from Ireland. And I want to show you a second video before we go any further now. This is the All-Ireland Schools Championships of the same year. So just bear with me to get this one on. It's coming out, just one moment.
Intermediate girls, 2,000 metres walk, right to left, Alicia Boylan, Monaghan, Aisling Hennigan, Westport, Claudine Lockton, Clare, Sarah Burke, Walston, Siobhan Nash, Haywood, Amy Mooney, Wicklow, Orla Butler, Waterford, Fiona Holmes, Doon, and Kate Field of St. Augustine's outside Dungarvan, wearing 15, are defending champion and record holder at this category. And a great start already inside the opening lap by Kate Field, who holds the record, the defending champion, set the mark of 8 minutes 45.07 seconds last year and is already looking imperviously good. Alicia Boylan of St. Louis and Monaghan currently in second place, ahead of Fiona Holmes of Mercy Convent Doon in third. Approaching the bell is Kate Veale, who's already qualified for the World Youth Olympics in Singapore next month, and about to lap Claudine Lee Lockton of Gael Scullin Clark. Looks in good form. Alicia Boylan of St. Louis takes the bell, about 200 metres behind. Superb performance from Kate Veale, this is. She's going to retain the title. She's going to break her own record brilliantly. 8 minutes 26.20 seconds. She's beaten her record by 20 seconds, and that is superb. One of only two Irish track and field athletes to compete next month in Singapore. It will be second place for Alicia Boylan of St. Louis Monaghan, a minute and a half behind, 9 minutes 49.89 seconds. Fiona Holmes, Mercy Convent of Doon in third, but our winner for the second year in a row at this grade is Kate Veale.
Well, Jamie Costin, who's an Olympian for Ireland, is in my club, so it was, I was really always wanted to do it when I saw him doing it. Like, I used to run when I was younger, I've been always in athletics, and there's also a brother Patrick Lennon in my school that kind of got me into it as well. So, well, I'm going to Singapore to the Youth Olympics. I was in Moscow there 2 weekends ago, so I qualified for out of Europe to go there. So that's in August, so that's the main event this year.
So guys, I hope you enjoyed that. That was Veale in the World Youth Olympic Games 2010, and then it was Kate winning the Irish Schools Championship. I just want to do one more quick screen share to do a little introduction, then we'll bring in Kate. I hope all of you could hear the sound on that, and keep yourselves on mute for the time being. It'll be great. So Kate Veale, if I can move the screen forward. I want to start off with that picture. It's probably every athlete's dream. You can see there's a full stadium behind Kate. And the great thing for all of us on this call from an Irish point of view is that there were bronze medalists from the World Under 18 Championships were from China and Russia. And I've been to both of those countries many times. They put huge resources into their athletics, and particularly their race walking. There's 1.4 billion people living in China. There's 150 million Russians. There's only 5 million Irish, but it was just a great day for everybody in Irish sport. Have one of our own girls on top of the world in 2011. And I just think that's a brilliant photograph of Kate. And that's her their medal as well from the World Youth Championships in 2011. The photograph over in the All-Ireland Schools, which I would hope every kid in the academy will be dreaming about competing in. And I'm sure there will be an All-Ireland Schools this year. This lockdown will not continue forever. And just to say as well, in her 5 years in secondary school in Ireland, won the All-Ireland Schools each of the years. She also ran for Ireland in the European Cross Country Championships in 2011, the year she won the World Championships. So she wasn't just a walker in terms of speciality. She also ran during the winter, and we would encourage all of our walkers in the academy to do cross country during the winter, to be part of a team, and obviously to keep that run space going when there's no walking races over the winter months. And I want to find the last picture of herself and her dad, James. He's been with her every step. Nobody's career runs in a straight line. There's always ups and downs. But so just to say to people today that we're going to focus just on Kate's teenage years, because effectively the academy is targeting all the teenage athletes. So we're going to focus only on Kate's teenage years to make it as relevant as possible to the academy members. So in terms of her CV, I've mentioned already, but you can't mention it too often. She was the World Youth Champion in 2011. She won 5 All-Ireland Schools Championships. She won 6 Irish Underage Championships, 8 Irish Underage Indoor Championships, and she was also the Irish Under 18 Cross Country Champion. So that just shows you the breadth of achievement she had. And I would imagine, and we can talk about it with Kate, sometimes you probably, it's very easy to forget the amount of success she had, but she had an incredible career and she'd always have these titles and these careers. And, you know, of course, the kids in the academy are hoping to do the same. She also won 4 Irish Senior Indoor Championships, 5 Irish Senior 5,000 metre walk championships on the track, and she won 3 Irish 20K walk championships as well. And she's the defending Irish 20K champion, an event which took place 1 week before they cut into lockdown last March. In terms of her major international honours, she was 4th in the Youth Olympics in Singapore in 2010. They were the first ever Youth Olympic Championships. In order to qualify for that, she went to the European Youth Olympic Trials in Moscow a couple of weeks earlier, and she finished 4th in them and was picked by Europe then to go to the World Youth Olympics as a 16-year-old. She was 3rd in the European Cup under 20 race in 2011. And just to show you the level she was at, the girl who won the junior, the under 20 race in 2011 became the Olympic champion a year later. And that's probably enough said about her. Kate also won the International School Championships twice for 2 years intermediate in the schools, which is under 17. She was a member 3 times of the International Schools cross country team. Again, it's an incredible achievement, the top 6 in the whole country. So to get out of your region and to get out of your province, then to go to All Ireland schools in the top 6. Get selected. She was a member of that team 3 times. She ran the European cross country for Ireland, and she's a multiple Irish record holder as well. So leads me very nicely on to Kate, and I'm hoping now I've stopped there in the screen. Yeah, I have, and I'm going to put Kate on pin so we can all see her. Kate, to see you. Let me just see if I can pin you up here. Lovely. Good morning, Kate. Welcome to the Robert Heffernan Academy. I know you've tried. Let me just, if you can unmute yourself. I know you've tried to join these classes. You've enjoyed these classes over the last number of Saturdays, and it's great to be on. Just to set the scene here, Kate, we were live CNN and Sky News, and we're also live Ox News and French and Russian news. So, hang on, but before we go any further, guys, can Brorsey, Caroline Murphy, and Daryl please mute yourselves? Because we want to be able to hear Kate. So if you could just mute yourselves, guys, show a bit of respect. We really appreciate it. So first of all, Kate, morning anyway to you. Lovely to have you on board. Can we go back to the beginning? You've done a lot of interviews in your time, but I would suggest that this interview is probably the one with the most knowledgeable spectator listeners. So you're not speaking to the general, but you're probably speaking to athletics experts here as well, and particularly walking experts. Can I go back to the very beginning and what got you involved in an athletic club for a start, and then what got you involved in race walking? What made you choose or what made you try walking?
Yeah, well, I suppose it's interesting to see, you know, the environment. My dad, I would have seen him out running, you know, doing marathons. And so I suppose I always had like an interest in trying it, but I did try every sport. I've, you know, tried everything. And that's why I think it's good for all the kids, everyone here to, you know, have a go at every sport. And, you know, you can find what ones then that you like. So, yeah, I started running with my club in West Waterford when I was about under 8 would have been my first, and cross country was my first love. More the longer kind of distances running. I would have tried every other event in athletics as well. And it's interesting because people can look sometimes and say, oh, you were so good when you were young and you won this and you won that. And I remember when I was very young, not even getting out of my school in primary school to do, there's a school sport. So you have to come top 3 in your school, in your class. So I wasn't even top 3 in my class. And I also remember in my counties, I was doing county B's and not getting medals. So it wasn't that, you know, some people think, oh, it's only when you're good when you're young, and people can get kind of discouraged from that. So it was just, yeah, I just really enjoyed it. And then, as I had said, as you heard in that earlier interview, Jamie Costin was in my club. And I suppose, like me, being able to see him and seeing that, oh, he's just from, you know, not too far from me, and he's able to compete at the world stage, and it was race walking that he was doing. So when I went to secondary school then, and there was a brother, Patrick Lennon, in that school that just said I'd try it out, and just really liked it, because I liked the idea that it's technical as well. As I suppose there's lots of, you know, it's just not just, I suppose, running. There's another part to it. And yeah, I really enjoyed that. It's like an extra challenge. And then I was doing running and walking, so which was good. It was great to, you know, cross over. And then eventually, I suppose, I was seeing, oh, race walking is, you know, the sport I prefer. So I focus a little bit more on that then.
Good. And Kate, there's a lot of key messages there with young kids on the call. We probably, I think we've about 150 in total on this, which is great to see. But some of the key messages there, we had Robert Knosky on 4 weeks ago, who's the greatest walker that ever lived, and his first race last and was lapped by a load of girls. You were saying the same thing as well, that, you know, you didn't immediately get success. I think it's really important for these kids as well. I think the key message you've said there were try every sport and try every event. Find what you like, first of all, and then what you're good at and what you enjoy doing. And then maybe put that more effort as you get into your teenage years. But also, don't expect the success. I think that's a key message, number one. You're not going to be the best in your club or in your county or in your region immediately. And stick with it as well. If you like it and you work harder with it, just stick with it. So, you know, I've given all your achievements there, Kate. But for the kids watching, I mean, Singapore and Moscow and these, they are a million miles away. The reality is, it was a million miles away from you at an early stage of your life as well. And you just stuck with the sport and you enjoyed it. They're the two key messages. What age were you when you did your first races? So the first time you baited a number onto your vest for probably was a running race. And then what age were you when you did your first walking race? And how do you feel going into your first walking race?
So I was under 8 for my first running race. It was cross country. And I was on a team. And I think I actually finished last on the team. So I wasn't even, I felt that I wasn't even much good to the team. And then for race walking, I was, I think, 12. And I kind of just was put in that. It was down in, it was in Waterford for like East Munster schools. And I actually was focusing on the 1500 and the 800. So, you know, that was, I didn't really think too much about the walk because when it's something new, sometimes it can be scary and you can be afraid that you're not good at it. And sometimes then you don't want to try it because, you can just have that fear. But I was put in for actually just to get points for the school. I was kind of, again, it was Brother Lennon said, oh, we'll throw you into the walk and see how you do. And had a few training sessions, but, and I kind of took me a while to get it. I didn't really know if I was doing it right. I wasn't really sure. And that was the first. I remember that was the first race and I really liked it. Yeah. And again, I didn't finish. I didn't get a medal anyway. And I was only East Munster schools. And that shows as well. It wasn't, you know, and at that time I was like, oh, I'm no good at this. I did think that when I started it, I was like, this is so hard. I'm going to stick to running. I didn't think that. And I didn't think I could progress at it, I suppose.
And I was going to say that as well. Kids in the modern world of mobile phones, kids expect immediate success. They see the X Factor. They see you going from singing in your sitting room to being a rock star. You know, the real world isn't like that. But just when you did your first race, you said you weren't that good. What we can, you know, that night when you're lying down in bed, you're thinking, might give this another go, or, you know, I really enjoyed it, I hope better. Do you remember what was in your mind as a young girl after your first walking race?
Yeah, well, for me, I suppose I actually just had that love for athletics. So, I kind of, at the back of my mind, you can have the dreams, but to me, I didn't believe them. I was kind of like, oh, wouldn't it be great? Or I was actually, and looking back, it wasn't the right way to think. I was wishing I was some of the other girls. I was saying, oh, I wish I was like her. I wish I was as, yeah, I remember thinking that, and I wanted to be them. And so that was probably, you know, and I was like, oh, I'd love, because I did love athletics, and I was like, I'd love to be good at this. And then I probably, that's when I searched other sports as well. I would have tried different things, and it's not all about, you know, being good. It was like seeing what you actually enjoy. And I suppose athletics was always my first love. And I just kept working hard, and I would have seen other people in my club, you know, that I could have looked up to. And it could have been, you know, the likes of Jamie and actually the Honourable Robert Korzenowski in 2004. He actually visited my club, and you know, that was the first time I kind of thought about race walking, thinking, oh, I'd like to try that. So the impact of seeing that these people are human beings and they have struggles, and that, you know, before, sometimes I would have looked at people that they're something special and that they're nearly a machine or something, and that I could never be that. But then seeing that all these people are all human beings and that they all work hard, and, you know, that's what gets them the success. But it's, yeah, enjoying it and the social aspect with your friends. And I see now how many of my friends now that I'm best friends with now are all through athletics. And there's just, that was a big part then as well of keeping me involved.
Yeah, I think there's lots of stuff we can all relate to. Being with your friends, enjoying the sport, you know, being part of something. So you're now 11 or 12 years of age and you've had your face, you're not that good, and you've looked, you weren't that good across country in your own head. What do you think then made the difference in your life? What was it that, I mean, you said you saw, you know, Robert Cardinale, you saw some of your heroes. You had Jamie Costin going to the Olympics in 2000 from your hometown. Robert Heffernan was down, I remember, at that event with Robert Gorzanowski when you had organized it, because Robert stayed at my house the following night. I remember that well, in February 2004. But what was it then that made your life change? That, you know what, I like this and I want to be better. What was the next steps?
Yeah, I think there was one part to me that, you know, and it's very important that everyone kind of, you know, develops their own self-confidence and have the belief in themselves, you know, because it's really important. And I think there was a part to me, you know, thinking little steps, because I started seeing tiny little bits of progression. Like, there might be one girl that I would beat then, say down in when I was training at my club, there might be one day I'd beat one girl that would always beat me, for example. And you know, just little things, or I go a bit faster. We used to have a little league where we time ourselves around the pitches, and I go a small bit faster. So then I'd see, oh, I am progressing. And then when you see a little bit of progress and you make little steps, it kind of gives you more, I suppose, drive and motivation to keep going, because you see what you're doing is working. And yeah, I think I enjoyed the hard work. I really, really enjoyed, because I saw that you get kind of a reward for it, and it is hard, and there's times you kind of feel you don't want to do it, or you're not sure should you be doing it, you know, doing it, or you can be not sure if this is right for you. But I think when you keep working hard, and that there is loads of obstacles and there's loads of, you know, difficult things that come in your way, but that everybody experiences them. And I think the hard work then will always, you know, come out on top, and it will always show. So I think that was, just starting to see little bits of progress along the way.
Yeah, and I think it's important. I mean, the way athletics is, about three medals. We give out a gold, silver, bronze medal. If there's 20 people in the race, we just award three. And the sport sends a message to the other 17, you're no good. Effectively, we get three medals and then guys don't get a medal, and the other girls. One of the great things in the challenges, and I've seen it week in, week out, because I'm recording all the times, is everybody's improvement week in, week out. You see the videos of the kids coming in from the parents. I see the times coming down, and you can see the kids that have improved. And that's the thing I'd like all the kids in the call to bear in mind. You know, Kate's initial challenge to go from a young girl in school to a world champion at under 18 was just an improvement week on week. And that's all you can do. You can't control any of the other things. You can only control your own career, your own life, and your own training. And in reality, what we're all doing in lockdown, and we will have races. We all know the fun of this sport is meeting your friends. The fun of this sport is having races and racing other people around the country. The important message is it's all about self-improvement, and that's the important thing with the challenges. So, Kate, just fast forward a bit on, you know, you mentioned you're and all the rest of it. When did you link up with Jamie Costin? So Jamie's a local Olympian. You're a young girl, you know, who was last in a cross-country team and did a walk and didn't qualify. What's brought on that relationship with your coach, and how much of an improvement did that give you then?
Yeah, so I was very lucky, Jamie in my club, and very lucky that at the start he was, you know, helped me out with some technique and, you know, little bits of race walk, and I was still running at the time. Now I'm trying to think of what age I was when he fully started coaching me. Maybe 14, but he would have started helping me before that. So again, having that and having someone who has done it, and like his achievements, that I was very, very fortunate and lucky. Like everybody here is very fortunate and lucky. The amount of people who've been successful in the sport that you can, you know, ask questions to, or that you can just get help from, it makes such a difference. That someone who that has been there and done it, I suppose. So yeah, that had a massive impact, and that then taught me a lot about training. So I before would have been taught you have to, you know, kind of, you know, work hard like every day, that you have to really I would have overworked maybe sometimes. It was like, you know, there's different types of sessions, and sometimes you have to do more easier sessions, whereas I was kind of like going full pelt all the time. And I learned a lot about training and how you train, and, you know, different types of sessions. And it was just fun. It was just fun to learn and to improve and to get little tips and little cues on, you know, little things that would have helped me to improve. So again, it was like it was just really good for me to see improvements, because, you know, at the end of the day, everyone is their own, you know, you should just compete against yourself sometimes. And I would have done this, you were looking at the other girls and focusing on them, whereas, you know, you're your biggest competitor, and it's, you know, you have to focus on. And as well as that, I remember I was only thinking there when I was thinking back there about cross country, when I remember going to Munster B's and finished way down the field, no one would ever have said that I was ever going to win, you know, a national cross country. A few years later, I would never have been picked, you know, as that. So yeah, it's just having the belief and just, you know, that it's all worth it in the end, that never give up kind of attitude. And to enjoy it along the way is most important.
Yeah, no, listen, Kate, I agree. And again, I miss everybody out there. In Robert Heffernan Racewalking Academy, there's coaches willing to give their time and energy who have been to 15 Olympic Games. And I've said this a number of times. Like, we have a world champion on the call, and the circuit training after is going to be a world senior champion and Olympic medalist. And when you look at, you know, the Irish athletics context, we're probably never have a sprints medal at world level. You know, we're probably never going to have a jumps and throws. You know, middle distance, we have a chance. You know, but walks, we're constantly strong on walks. And just to say, Kate Veale isn't even the first Irish walker to get a World Youth medal. We've got a girl from Guyane, Lochnan, got a World Youth medal in 2003. And she's going to be on the call in the next week or two as well. And she's going to share her story. So, you know, this is an event where we can actually, you know, get success at a global level. Another message Kate gave about asking for help. And I've learned that myself, even coaching my own in Galway. So everybody now is home from school. They're probably training all the time. They've more energy. And I've noticed in my own group, I have to pull them back constantly and advise them not to train too hard. So don't get in the habit of training hard every single day. You train, you recover. You train, you recover. That's how it works. Be afraid to ask for help. And don't ever think that you're not good enough. If Kayla's saying, you know, I was last in the cross country, I wasn't able to do the walks or whatever, you know, national cross country champion at under 18, everybody can achieve their own goals and their own potential. Just believe in yourself. And that's another piece that Kate gave out. Guys, I want to open the question to the floor. So I'm going to go through what's in the chat box. But if anybody, it's a chance you probably never get. And even Kate, I just want to say thanks. You know, we never have this chat. I know all about your career through Jamie, so don't worry about that. I'm well aware of all ups and downs and everything. And actually, Jamie, I might just throw you on if you can take the call. What would you say as a coach when a local 14-year-old or 15-year-old comes and asks for help? What did you see in her and how did you manage it? And did you ever see when that 14-year-old came to you that 3 years later and you'd be coaching a World Youth Champion? So over to you, Jamie.
Yeah, thanks, Pierce. I suppose the first thing I saw was when Kate came to me first, she was running, like she said, she was down at East Munster. She was running the 1500, the 800 and doing the walk all at the same time. So when James would have approached me first about helping out with Kate, I was going to get help with technique, but with training, I can't because she's running and she's walking. So she's doing so many sports, there's no point in being specific. So she was doing loads of different races, like distances, cross country, everything. And it was brilliant, but there was no point in me trying to put a structure around her training when there was so much else, other things going on. So what we did is, you were 15, Kate, when I first said yes.
Okay.
And the first thing I did was, can I have your training diary? And Kate actually said it earlier. Kate's problem wasn't she wasn't doing enough. Kate's problem was she wanted to do everything every day. So Kate used to do double training sessions. And for me, how I got trust with Kate was the first thing I said was, you're going to be training much easier. But give me 2 or 3 months, and if you're not doing PBs, you can start giving out to me about training. But we literally cut her training in half, and she started doing PBs all over the place. So it just showed that having a small bit of structure around your training actually can help you get a lot quicker.
Yeah, and I think that's a really good bet as well, Jamie. I think people now, particularly lockdown, because they're home all the time, want to train hard, and because there's so much company academy, people are pushing themselves hard, but you're absolutely right. Again, a message to people, and this is not to rest more, but this is to recover after hard training more and try and push yourself. And Jamie even said that he was 14 or 15 before he agreed with a structure in Kate. I think it's fine that you try all the sports. You're playing a bit of football, you're playing a bit of camogie, you know, you're doing a bit of cross country, walking is one of your sports. I think that's absolutely fine. But there will come a time as a distance increase when you have to put in a little bit more distance and you do need a bit of help. And there's enough coaches on the academy, and there's enough coaches around the region that people can get that expertise, which might be there as prominent when we were younger. Jamie, what else say to kids in the academy now looking at this? What would be your message be to, you know, there's probably boys and girls from 10 to 18. And as somebody who's been to a few Olympics and World Championships and you've coached a World Youth Champ, you know the trials and tribulations. What advice would you give the kids on a call like this?
This goes back to what Kate said as well. First, she said learning, doing the different things with technique, The different training sessions, not hitting yourself every day, it was fun. The training was fun, and it was sort of as a progressive training that enabled you to get better. And this is what's happening on the academy. Your Saturday challenges are encouraging everybody to focus on a different aspect of training every week. It's keeping it fresh, it's keeping it fun, but also doing the other 2-3 days or 4 days a week, sorry, 3 days to 4 days a week, where you're actually doing the other training to feed into the training on a Saturday, you know? And that's where everybody's going to meet improvements, by being consistent, going out and doing the training, but most importantly, having fun, whether it's with your friends, whether it's with your new buddies on Zoom, whether they're in Ireland, in Tuam or Ring or in South Africa, it doesn't matter where they are. But like, you've got a fantastic group of people that you can all share what you're doing with. You can see what they're doing. And like Pierre said, this lockdown isn't going to last forever. We're all going to be eventually able to meet and get to know each other properly face to face. So I think that's what everybody should be focusing on here, doing the 3 days to 4 days a week, enjoying what you're doing. It's only 25 minutes, 35 minutes, 3 days a week. It's very little time in your week, but enjoy it, be focused on it while you're doing it, and then look forward to meeting everybody and challenging yourself against people, because the most important thing we do is race. So looking forward to getting time to be able to race in a couple of months' time.
Yeah, good. Kate, I'm going to take a few questions, and thanks for that, Jamie. Just Jane asked, how old were you when you started race walking? So I think you've answered that, have you? More or less. Yeah. What age was your first race?
It was first year in secondary school, 12, maybe 13. Yeah. And it was kind of like, I didn't really think too much of it because, as Jane was saying, it was kind of the running. I was just like, oh, I'll just go into that and try it. Yeah.
Good. So you had no fear to try interventions. Great. Ava and Jack, how many times a week did you train back when you were, I'd say, 14, 15?
Yeah, so I would have, at that age, so I was at my club running. They would have done maybe 3 days a week, and then I would have done my own stuff. So exactly the same as what Jamie said as well. There wasn't structure to it, though. So which was actually, wasn't as beneficial as Jamie said when there was a structured program put in place and actually see progression. And yeah, that year when Jamie started coaching me, every race I went out, I was kind of getting PBs. And I was kind of like, wow, it was, yeah, to see that proper solid progression. But I was doing, so I was kind of running, I was cycling a bit, I was swimming, I had started doing like circuits and Pilates. So at that age, I was really eager to learn, and I really enjoyed just trying out everything. And I was, you know, anything that was going to help my athletics, I kind of tried it out. So I got really into just exploring, I suppose, all them different. So I was actually doing something every day. That's I kind of got into that routine of, but I'm not saying that, you know, that was the right thing to do. But it was just for me something that's the way I suppose was doing it before I was coached properly.
Sometimes everything's the right thing, but it's right for you, and that's important as well. Jim Clover asks, what's the thing you're most proud of?
A difficult one. Probably, like, it would have to probably be the World Youth, really, I suppose. And like you said earlier, Pierce, like, I would have looked at the likes of the Chinese and the Russians and always been curious as to what they were doing and thought they were, like, you know, like, again, machines are in a different world, or that it was, you know, never thought that I would ever be able to beat them. I just kind of had, you know, that they're the powerhouses of walking, and that they're different or something, you know. So yeah, for me then to see, and like anyone here, so it just shows any of you can, you know, do that. And, you know, don't think sometimes we can all look at people like that in other countries and think that we can never get to that level. Whereas, and I really did think that, but you actually can. So that was probably the biggest,
good. John, we're going to hold your question till the end, okay? John last said, what are your cross training routines when you're injured or tired? You didn't really get many injuries as an injured, did you, as I remember?
Quite lucky when I was younger, nothing major. But I would have done a lot of aqua jogging. That was something when I was very young I started doing, and I found it really beneficial. So even some mornings I'd go down, I was very lucky now as well, there was a pool near close by to me. So swimming and aqua jogging, I found with the, since non-weight bearing. And I, as I said, I would have really enjoyed doing with my senior club. I remember asking, I was like, can I join the senior club to the circuits? There was someone there that did circuit training. And then I started Pilates very young as well. And I think, some of the people were probably like, this one shouldn't be allowed to come in here or whatever. But yeah, that kind of stuff. But I just enjoyed, you know, movement and learning, I suppose, about your body and, you know, the things that I can do, I suppose. So yeah, I think that stuff, all that kind of thing definitely stood to me. And I suppose for the younger kids, a mixture of sports and just being, yeah, just moving and trying different sports, and that can keep your body in good condition. And athletics, I think, is a foundation for so many sports. So even the circuits that you're doing today, or it can have, it can help in any sport. It's the foundation, that kind of movement.
Yeah, no, good one, Kate. You've made circuits a number of times. I know Rob Heffernan and his glamorous assistants waiting to do circuits. There's one last question, and I'm going to invite both Jamie and Rob to answer this question each. It's from John Connors. I think it's a really good question. So John Connors' question is, if a walker is doing endurance running, walking, what age do you recommend they focus on just walking, or can they go hand in hand away? I have my own opinion, but I'm going to hand this to Jamie first and then to Heffernan. So Jamie, thoughts on that?
I think it's down to the athlete, because it's like when Kate might have been playing hockey or football or hurling and might wanted to go on since she was a minor and keep on playing, doing those 3 days, 4 days a week, doing a different sport. Kate at 13 or 14 was hoping that I'd coach her, but she was running, and I wasn't able to commit to that, because I said, you're doing other sports, so enjoy them. While you're enjoying other sports, keep on doing them. But when you know you want to focus on one sport, then go for it hard. Even as I said, that Kate was still doing her walking training 3 days, 4 days a week. So you can do the training and develop your body and develop things you go on, but it's entirely up to the athlete when they actually want to focus on one sport. And I think until you're 16 or 17, that's a choice you should be allowed to make, you know, whatever sport you want to do.
Yeah, I fully agree. And I know even with all my group, every does a team sport, football, camogie, whatever it is. So I'm strongly encouraged. Rob, do you want to have a comment on that before you do circuits? Are you happy enough to do the circuits when it goes off? Rob, over to you, yeah.
The same, Pierce, as what Jamie was saying. I think like even my Cahill, as I said before, has raced, walked. He's won walking races when he was a kid. He's won Munster indoor titles. He's sprinted. Now he's playing football with Ireland. I think when you get to 15, 16, and in my case, I probably developed a little bit later, but your sport nearly kicks you at a point. But back, like some of the very interesting points here, even listening to Jamie, the essence of sport when you're going is being competitive. Not comparing yourself to other people, but lads, competition is good and wanting to win. It doesn't necessarily mean you're going to win. You know, not everyone can win, but we can all try our best to win. And I think people are afraid now to say that in society, like that, oh, it's about taking part. No, I still want to win now, but I can't. I'm just getting older and fatter and I can't, you know. So wanting to win and wanting to compete is good. And you could do that in every sport. But I think when you hit 15, 16, 17, you're like going, why am I good at this feckin' race walking? I wanted to be 6'5" in a sprinter, like, you know? So all of these things will happen naturally with you lads. But don't ever forget, it's the mundane chore every day that gives the enjoyment to competing. And just on the lads' points, I had a Norwegian athlete who I'm coaching yesterday, and I said, you need to work on your heel strike. You need to work on your foot rolling through. You need to work on your knees staying extended. And he says, yes, you have said this to me many times, and I am trying to do this every day. And I'm at the end of the phone, and he goes, yeah, and if I'm working with you for another 20 years, I'll probably be saying the exact same thing, because it's every day you need to keep doing the same thing. And it's people who are comfortable and working hard every day. So lads, there's no mystery. So now we're moving on to the circuits. There's no mystery with the circuits either. We're going to suffer here for a half an hour, and that's it.
Let me just finish, Kate. Listen, you're absolutely right. Just two things, guys. First of all, huge thanks to Kate. Kate, you know, regardless of how life turns out, we're proud of your achievements. And I hope this morning you can look back at the number of titles you've won. And someone like me presents it in a statistical format. I hope you're very proud of your achievements. And I hope you can look back with joy and pleasure at what you achieved at a point in your time. Being a world champion is a very rare thing. So thank you very much for your time. Really appreciate it. And I hope everybody on the call enjoyed it. And second point, before I introduce the circuits, I was speaking to Rob during the week about how we could make the Saturday more exciting, and we were going to go around and pick an exercise and give it to each kid to lead. And Rob just said a very good thing, and he just reinforced it there. The core work we need to do, guys, is our race walking and our strength training. This is hardening. That's why we do it. We're not going to have great on the circuit training. This is about the core business of what we're trying to do. Yes, we're all walkers, runners, footballers, camogie players, whatever it is. The circuit training will make you all better sports people and better athletes. That's the key point. So without further ado, we're going to leave Waterford. We're going to go back from Galway down to Cork. Thank you very much, Jamie. Rob, I'm going to pin you up, okay? And it's over to you, Rob. Thanks a million, guys, and I hope everyone enjoyed that.
Thanks, Pierce. Thanks, Kate. All right, lads, you all ready to go?